Hi everyone. Our today's topic is how did the Renaissance begin? If you remember in our previous video, we had talked about the concept of Renaissance. By now, I am sure that most of you who have attended to that video will be clear about the concept of Renaissance. Today, it is another question which is equally tricky and important also. Because as a student of English history, I have come across so many people who are not very clear about the arrival of this movement. So let's begin with our discussion. First, we talk about the background. We need to appreciate the background of the times in which the Renaissance movement started. When you look at the background, we see that the Crusades, they continued for some 300 years or maybe two or three centuries. And these Crusades kept many Christians engaged fighting the Muslims and particularly the representatives of the Ottoman Empire, which we generally call Khilafat-e-Usmaniya. So once these Crusades were over, we don't go into the details of Crusades. Maybe at some point of time when we come here, we will be referring to these Crusades. But generally speaking, after these Crusades were finished, you can imagine that those people who were disturbed by these Crusades or who kept fighting their enemies did not find time to study, to explore, and to make certain adventures. So once these fights were over, these battles were over, the soldiers in particular had ample time to spend in other activities. And when I say other activities, you can imagine what I mean. Other activities include learning and the quest for knowledge and reading and of course improving the quality of life. So the Crusades and the subsequent scenario was equally important for this search in learning about classical writers. If you remember in our previous video, we had referred to this tendency in that particular period when people felt more inclined to learn about classical writers and classical writings. So there, the Crusades was the one good contributor in this search. Now, when you have this tendency to learn about classical writers and classical writings, it does not necessarily mean that you will be only reading at home. It means that you will be visiting libraries, you will be visiting different places, and you will be moving around in order to increase the amount of knowledge you have. And that movement basically enabled the Europeans to encounter new knowledge and new cultures. Means they did not get enough time during the Crusades to move around, but now they were comparatively free and at peace to learn for themselves and to search for good things that they liked. So this was a brief background to the beginning of the Renaissance. Now there were certain transformations that were taking place, particularly in the 12th century and afterwards. So here we talk about 12th century and of course 13th, 14th and 15th. So this will expand over the rest of the centuries. Now, there were so many transformations. If we pick few of them, one transformation was at the church level, at religious level. Generally speaking, people were not satisfied with the church to strike a balance between spiritual and material life. Now, even in the modern days, if you imagine the religious teachings, most of the times you see that those people who are at the helm of the affairs, who control religious institutions, they tilt either toward this world or to that world. They may not be tilting to this world because they belong to the religious class, but in comparison, there is a secular class, there is a material class, who are more interested in the affairs of this world. So there has always existed a polarization between the religious and the non-religious sections of the society. So most of the times in the medieval situation, in the Middle Ages, we see that the people were not satisfied from their religious clerics, their scholars, to tell them, to inform them, to teach them what was the actual balancing situation that they could exercise to keep their lives at par and according to the religious standards in alignment with this world and the world hereafter. So in a sense, in the medieval times, the church people were more interested in teaching morality and abstract ideals and about the life hereafter. When it would come to material things, their interest and their attention would be not according to the expectations of the general public. So in a sense, a distrust was developing, a gap was developing between the church people and the common people. So this was a transformation taking place in the medieval times, and this is important for you because as long as you do not appreciate this topic, this transformation, you may find it difficult to see the wave of secularism or the promotion of secularism, or when people started welcoming secularism in the Renaissance time. And we see that during the Renaissance period, there was a gradual shift from religiosity or from religion towards secularism. So people were moving from religion towards secularization, and that secularization was one basic outcome of this failure of the church to provide a stable framework for organizing spiritual and material life. So this was one transformation. Another transformation was the rise in city-states and national monarchies. Now, this may be somehow confusing for some students, but if you combine this transformation with this one, and that this is the development of national languages, in a sense we see that there was a sense of growing nationalism in the medieval times. If you remember, somewhere in our discussion about the Middle Ages, and particularly in the context of the Hundred Years' War, in one of our videos we had talked about the outcome of the Hundred Years' War and Black Death. Means the French were fighting against English, and English were fighting against the French, and there were other wars and battles taking place, as we refer to the Crusades here. This was another series of battles fought between the Christians and the Muslims. So all these wars and all these strifes and struggles between different nations gave rise to a sense of growing nationalism and a sense of feeling of differences from other people. Geography started developing geographical boundaries, and then of course nationalism. People started taking pride in their own nations, in their own languages, and they started feeling different from the rest of the nations. So this was again a transformation that was taking place. The next transformation was the breakup of old feudal system, and I do not go into the details of this transformation, because in our last video about what is Renaissance, we have already given time to this point. Now we come to the Renaissance. This is the background and these are the transformations. So this has nothing to do with how did the Renaissance begin. These events and these circumstances form the background of the Renaissance, or you can say that they paved the way for this movement which we call the Renaissance. Now when you talk about Renaissance, it was not a single-faced movement, like means there were so many aspects and facets of this movement. It had its indications and revelations in art, in literature, in history, in science, in education, in philosophy. So painting, architecture, every single field of life was in the grip of this Renaissance tendencies. But if we want to make our task of understanding and appreciating Renaissance in a befitting manner, we go for humanism, and we say that there may be several factors responsible for the beginning of the Renaissance, but it was actually the humanists who initiated this movement. And here we come to this concept of humanists. So if we understand humanists and humanism, we have completed answer to our question, how did the Renaissance begin? So inviting your attention and requesting you to spare some more time, let's try to understand the concept of humanism. This humanism was actually a system of education and a mode of inquiry. Means there was a kind of a thinking behind educating the people irrespective of their ages. Means it would include the old and the young in giving them equal importance. So what kind of system of education and mode of inquiry was this humanism? So this, we say that this system was actually initiated by secular men of letters in Italy. Means there were educated, scholarly, intellectual people in Italy who supported and promoted this humanism. It has, of course, historical roots in classical literature, and if you Google this concept, you will come across many historical references on the basis of which the concept of humanism rests. But we, for the sake of clarity and brevity, we don't go into those details. Now, if you talk about this system of education and mode of inquiry, we say that let's try to understand what this system was about. Actually, its central emphasis was on human realm and human virtue. Means that man was at the center of everything for this education. And this virtue basically refers to the analytical ability and a questioning attitude. This actually is a secular tendency that we have talked about here. These secular people, they were not very much attracted toward the orthodox religion. And here we have talked about the failure of the church. So these people attempted to secularize people in a sense, to get out of the clutches of religion, which have made their lives fixed, and which according to these people prevented them from thinking for themselves and taking initiative and making decisions and judgments on their own. So what this system advocated was that we should have analytical ability. We should analyze things. We should not accept things the way we hear them, the way we listen to them. Means people will be telling us different things from philosophy, from religion, from spirituality, from mysticism, but our job is not to accept them in toto. Means whatever they say, you say, yes, you are right. No, this is not the right approach. You must have this ability. You should inculcate this ability of analyzing for yourself. So you should have analytical ability and a questioning attitude. Now, this questioning attitude is again in contrast to the concept of religious teachings and the church. In church and in religion teachings, normally people are not encouraged to question. So this secular approach was basically motivated to force, to drive the people to think for themselves, to make them understand things before accepting them. And according to these people, these men of letters, they said that this should be the actual aim of education. And this is how you have a mode of inquiry. When you question things, and on the basis of your questions, you get to a certain reality. Now, another important thing about humanism is that this system of education would teach individual initiative. Now, how do we understand individual initiative? You say, I can, I will. Now, this is your initiative. Or we say that you can and you will. It means you have the ability to do many things. If not everything, many things. So instead of confining or isolating yourself from the world of practicality, you should come to the front, you should take the initiative, and always believe that you are not created fixed. Fixed in a sense that your creation is not predestined, it is not predetermined. You have freedom to create your own future. Means if you have a desire to do something, you can do that. So the question is, the need is to nourish that desire in yourself. Once you feel that desire, then you can reach the ultimate reality. And lastly, before this concept, which is very important, I would come here, and it was this humanism was boosted by the fall of Constantinople in 1453. Sultan Mehmed II of Ottoman Empire defeated the Christian forces in Constantinople in 1453, and as a result, the Christians, they vacated Constantinople. It fell into the hands of the representative of Ottoman Empire, and you know that this was perhaps the last line of defense of the Crusaders and the Christians to check the growing expansion of the Ottoman Empire. Once they lost this Constantinople, these Christian Europeans, they went to different parts of Europe, they settled there. And again, if you remember this point when we talked about the end of the Crusades, in a sense, again here, they got time and opportunity to read and to learn for themselves. So this was a blessing in disguise, you can say, for the Europeans, that on the one hand, of course, apparently they lost their fort, the line of defense, but on the other hand, they got a chance, they got a time to learn many other things, and they later on proved to be of similar importance, not only to them, but to the rest of the world. Now, the last topic, which is more important to humanism and to Renaissance, of course, is anthropocentric versus theocentric. In the medieval times, and before the medieval times, after the arrival of Christianity, the world was theocentric. What do we mean by theocentric? We mean that according to theocentrism, God is the center of the universe. Everything revolves around the concept of God. Means whatever you say, whatever you do is because of God. So you never dissociate yourself from the concept of God. Whenever you interpret life, it is actually the concept of God that is going to drive your interpretation of life. Now, in more simple words, you can say that religion was at the center of the universe, and whenever you would find any problem or difficulty or question, it would be the religion that would answer to your queries. So in a sense, the whole world was, and particularly the Christian world, was theocentric. But with the arrival of the Renaissance and this growing tendency of secularization, and of course the failure of the church, there was a transformation taking place from theocentrism to anthropocentrism. And anthropocentrism is basically the opposite of theocentrism. In anthropocentrism, we say that man is at the center of the universe. Means you can do whatever you want. You remember that we in history and in literature study character is destiny. Now, this character is destiny basically is anthropocentrism.